that would be unfair to you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another segment of Asaph Cafe. I am your host, Asaph Adonai, and we're on our brand new set. And for today's edition, I'd like to introduce Emmett again. He's been on our show before.
Yep.
And our regular guest, Linda Brooks Curtis, she's here, and it's always a delight to have her on the show. And our host is Patty Reed. She'll be on the next show with our mascot, Pee-wee. So we're going to just enjoy this show. We have our lunch here in the cafe and our food.
Mm-hmm.
And I will start out with the traditional, "This Guy's in Love with You."
Mm-hmm.
It's my favorite song.
Yep.
Thanks for joining me, guys. Today is fun.
Certainly.
Our pleasure.
Listening is so beautiful.
Thank you.
Brings back lots of memories.
Yep. Yeah, I'm just blessed to be able to do this, to share this here.
Yep. So many times I've listened to this type of stuff on the radio, TV, and just done my dishes or home, you know, homework. I did that a lot, like I said, in high school, or done a lot of work around the house. And without this music, I can't do any homework or chores. I gotta have this on when I have chores.
Same
or something.
With me.
Yeah, yeah.
Or SOS radio.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, SOS radio. Yeah.
Or YNOP.
I guess that means we're audio-oriented.
Yes.
Well, welcome both of you to the show today. Oh, you don't know this because you weren't here. This is our fourth season now of doing Asaph Cafe.
Oh, wonderful.
We're in our fourth season. This is episode number 2.
Wonderful.
So, I'm very blessed to get to do this show and share this with our TV audience and our guests that appear on this show.
Mm-hmm.
So, every 15 episodes, we call it a new season.
Interesting.
Well, because it would be impossible to do it a literal year like regular television.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yeah.
So,
a lot of those things are shot in that amount of time anyway.
Well, perhaps, but I mean, just for this show here, and it's cool to always get, you know, new sets. And you wait till you see the next set for season 5.
Oh.
Yeah, that's going to look like we're on the Lawrence Welk show. I'm getting that prepared.
Oh, wonderful.
You know, a little ballroom set. But in the meantime, this cafe here, this Vegas set, I guess, that's what we're going to be doing, so...
It looks beautiful, like something out of a dream, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe we should bless our food first. We have this wonderful food donated from the Senior Citizen Center. So.
Yeah, I want to thank them. I was playing there earlier today. I was playing earlier there, and they gave me this food for this show.
Wonderful. Maybe we should say a blessing over the food.
Sure, you go ahead. Go for it.
Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the food we are about to receive through the bounty of Christ our Lord and this wonderful show and time together. Bless the set and bless the show they were going to do. And may the souls of the faithfully departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And I pray the blessings, too, on the show, on today's show.
Yes. Amen. Yep.
Play Sinatra while you're praying is pretty cool, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I love Cole Porter.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
This is my very favorite in this night and day. No, excuse me, in the still of the night.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'll try to do that one for you.
But I've heard Night and Day, and I love it. I heard it on the radio. Listening radio. And then on Lawrence Welk, they covered it, you know? Beautiful.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The good Lord has blessed me. I'm glad I can share this with the people.
Yeah?
I like your flower tie.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, it's been really hot. And I used to love the heat. I was born in a hot climate, Tucson, but I'm not used to it. Maybe it's the humidity, too. But heat just, at an older age, just gets to me anymore.
Saps your energy.
Yeah, it does anymore.
This meatloaf is really good, and this is kind of cool to
have my
real
food
on
potatoes.
Camera.
Baked potatoes. Yay. With
green baked potatoes, meatloaf, and I like the string beans.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Too bad we can't give you some through the camera.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's been very hot. It's just been unbelievable here, I think.
How's your summer
Going quite well. It's going well, yeah.
Good. This show will probably just be more laid back today, but...
Yeah.
You'll still see yourself a couple of weeks from now on television. And like I tell all the guests, sit here talking and eating. I'm going to give you a copy of today's show, too, so...
Wonderful.
And by then it will be Father's Day, so I really think we should... some sort of...
Oh, yeah.
When is Father's Day? Is it next week?
It's the 21st.
19th.
Mm. Is it the 21st?
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe next week we can do a Father's Day show on the cafe here.
I would like that.
But, you know, I feel blessed to do this show, and how this show came about last September I was preparing that new Lawrence Welk show, and... we did the promo, Luis and I, the hostess.
Uh-huh.
We did this promo for about an hour, and then I had like 3 hours filming time left after we did the promo.
Mm-hmm.
And at the start of that promo, I just said, "Welcome to Asaph Cafe."
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, kind of just said it.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have the concept of this show at that time. And so after we did that promo, I said, you know, I can use that, Asaph Cafe. We got 3 hours of filming time. Let's just call it Asaph Cafe.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And so that's how this got started. And Stacy Bear was with me on that occasion. So she's a real sweetie. She works at the First Security Bank.
And, interesting,
So that's how it was birthed, Asaph Cafe.
Sudden inspiration.
Yeah, and the this show is based on Humphrey Bogart's Casablanca. You know that scene when he says, "Play it again, Sam"?
No, I've never seen Casablanca.
Well, they were
they were
in a cafe, so that's kind of where I got the idea too. So it's kind of a combination when we did that promo and Humphrey Bogart's Casablanca, and that's how Asaph Cafe was born, you might say.
I love this set. It reminds me kind of a dream. Just kind of like dreams I've had, and I've probably said this on my show, where I've had dreams about being in fancy restaurants with incredible food and a backdrop like
this.
Well,
we're kind of doing that today, so,
I like,
you know.
The fact it's so mellow, it has a dreamlike quality. I really like that, you know. It's kind of nice, you know. A good dream, though. A good one, you know.
Well,
okay.
It reminds me of the Range Restaurant at the top of Harris in Las Vegas, which is actually a very, very elegant restaurant.
Mm-hmm. Oh, MASH. That was what the theme to MASH, yeah. You know, I never cared much for MASH. I know you probably are fans of MASH. I don't know if you like MASH, but...
It's alright.
Yeah. I never laughed once at MASH. I found it... Wasn't it meant to be a comedy or a comedy
Well,
drama?
Here's the history of it. You know, I come from a military family, so my birth mother was not a fan of the MASH television show either. And I think the reason for that is because she was married to a military man. So she's been in that all her life, that when they put that show together, that just didn't work for her.
Mm-hmm.
And the original MASH, the movie before the series, had Elliot Gould and I forget the other actor's name.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very offensive to me.
Oh, interesting. I never saw the first one.
It was, you know, they were doing that time frame and the context. So I understand that, but it was still very offensive. They, like the African-American fella that was on the MASH movie, they kept calling him Spear Chucker. That didn't sit well with me.
Yeah.
And so I'm even surprised that the series got made because of the movie. Whereas when they did the series, it was more comedy. And the movie was comedy, but it was more of a harsh, serious kind of comedy.
And it involved more credible actors like Harry Morgan.
Yeah, I know. I realize that. And I realize that they had to do that for the time to make that believable, but it still didn't sit well with me. But then when they did these series with Alan Alda, it was more comical and it worked.
And it was more easy to relate because the movie MASH had this sarcastic, sardonic Elliot Gould playing, which, I mean, it was authentic to the character from the novel. But at the same time that movie came out, I was in a show called We Bombed in New Haven, which was a total comedy, and it really wasn't about war, but it was funny. But I knew a couple of the writers, the main writers from, I can't remember the name of the one that I met in Las Vegas, from MASH, and Larry Gelbar, of course, was but it was more humane, and it was more about presenting a moral, you know, the moral of the story. And so it was like each episode actually presented a moral, and it wasn't something that left you cold.
Interesting. Mind if we talk about one of my favorite subjects that I've always talked about? Easy listening. I was thinking about easy listening artists, like the light and the mood. Just not even that, but of course, you know, I found some of my favorite easy listening artists on KUEZ FM. You know, the Music Missoula relaxes too. I've talked about that so much, and I still miss that station horribly. But I found like John Denver, Neil Diamond, and Gordon Lightfoot, all from that station, because they would play Gordon Lightfoot, Neil Diamond. I'd love John Denver, you know. Have a lot of his albums. And, you know, Neil Diamond, they would often play Neil Diamond. Reverend Blue Jeans. No, Living in Blue Jeans. I would be, you know, sweeping the floors. I'd be sweeping the floors, you know, and doing at my parents' house, you know, doing chores. Had the radio on. And it would come on, you know, Reverend... you ever heard of misheard lyrics? Where you mishear the lyrics? I thought it was Reverend Blue Jeans, not Living in Blue Jeans. I thought it was about a reverend who was very relaxed and just wore blue jeans to church and to his congregation. And it was Reverend Blue Jeans. He's some... And I couldn't understand the words, but I just loved it. Reverend Blue Jeans.
Okay.
What a nice pastor. What a... Wears blue jeans and there's a casually people to the Lord. I thought whoever's singing this, I learned it was Neil Diamond. That's awesome. I just love Reverend Blue Jeans. Of course, it's Living in Blue Jeans. It's not.
Well, I guess I don't really know that song, but cool.
Reverend Blue Jeans.
He ain't happy. He's my brother.
You know, I don't know that one well enough to play publicly. That's the second time somebody's asked me to do that. I never took time to really learn that song. I've heard it. I just never actually put it into my repertoire.
I've never heard He's My Brother from Neil Diamond.
No. He ain't happy, he's my brother.
It's a song from the past.
Look it up on YouTube.
I've heard it, I just don't know how to play it.
And the other one, it was Hello, I Said. Hello, I Called. I Said.
Hello, I called, I've said. Is that it or no? That's someone else.
Hello, I said. To no one there.
And now, not even the chair. I heard that on KUEZ and I loved it. Hello, I said, no one even heard, not even the chair. Oh, yeah, I love that.
And can you play Sunshine on My Shoulder?
Oh, I love that, yeah.
Don Denver?
Yeah. Oh, I love that song. I've got a lot of his CDs.
I came out when my nickname was Sunshine.
But what really got me into Neil Diamond was a relative I, you know, have, you know, a relative... We've agreed to disagree on easy listening. She hates easy listening in the Lawrence Welkin and this type of stuff. I love it, but we've agreed to disagree. And for Christmas, she sent me a small little package, you know, wrapped up.
That's all I know on that. Keep going.
Yeah. And said,
thank you.
And she wrote on, "Dear Emmett, this is so sickening, so horrible, so completely nauseating that I knew you'd probably like it." I opened up Christmas Day, and it was a tape of Neil Diamond's Moods, which is actually one of my favorite albums of all time. It's actually my favorite. I put it on, and I just loved it. I love Song Sun Blue, and that was on it, and I just loved it, and I was hooked on Neil Diamond ever since.
But there's nothing like Gordon Lightfoot's Canadian Railroad Trilogy.
Yes.
And his other songs like Sundown.
Yeah, Sundown's okay, but I love Gordon Lightfoot. I love Gordon Lightfoot. Absolutely. I have him on every day.
Well, there's a little bit of Neil Diamond. Now, let's talk about Neil Diamond for a second.
Yeah.
You know, I always was a fan of his,
mm-hmm.
but you know what really made me appreciate Neil Diamond even
what?
More? There was a story on the world news, and the
mm-hmm.
topic was prayer,
mm-hmm.
and there were some atheists that were defiant and telling the world that prayer
mm-hmm.
doesn't work, and they didn't
mm-hmm.
believe in God and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they had the story on the world news, it was on Nightline, I believe, on the world news where there was this hurricane that had gone
mm-hmm.
through this whole neighborhood and wiped out this whole neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
You know, all the houses in the entire neighborhood?
Mm-hmm.
And it happened to be Christians that lived in this neighborhood. So they had a prayer meeting.
Uh-huh.
And they showed it on camera where, like, all the people in the
mm-hmm.
neighborhood were just bowing their head to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And they're asking for help, you know, because they had lost their homes. And what people didn't realize is that Neil Diamond was sitting in the audience. But nobody recognized him because they had lost their homes. So they were focusing on crying out to God for help, right?
Uh-huh.
So what Neil Diamond decides to do after that prayer meeting
uh-huh.
is he did a concert. And raised all, I think it was like $1 million or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes back to that neighborhood and restored the entire neighborhood. And this is after these atheists said that God doesn't answer
prayer.
See? So, and then when they played the tape back after Neil Diamond was restoring the houses, and they played the prayer meeting back, they saw Neil Diamond sitting in the audience in this prayer meeting. So he goes and does this concert, and he goes back to the neighborhood and restored the entire neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
So I guess the people that say that there's no prayer and that prayer don't work had egg on their face because they're just adamant that prayer doesn't work.
Yeah.
And Neil Diamond was sitting in the audience. So how do you explain that? How do you explain that there's a famous person sitting in a prayer meeting, unobserved, unrecognized because of the you know, crying out
uh-huh.
in their home. So when they showed the houses rebuilt and Neil Diamond was in the neighborhood, all the neighbors say, "Hey, anytime you want to be in this neighborhood, you can stay in any one of these houses here."
Wonderful.
Right on.
Absolutely.
So,
well,
you know, and that made me appreciate Neil Diamond even more, that he would do something like
mm-hmm.
that for people. They could take his music,
mm-hmm.
do a concert, raise all this money, and go back and restore the entire neighborhood. So
that's
I just thought
wonderful.
It was way cool.
I can't remember the artist. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Oh, that's Matt Redman.
Matt
and
Redman.
The name of that song is called 10,000 Reasons. 10,000
Reasons.
I'll do it for you. I'll do it for you.
Well, this is my story regarding that. My brother lives in Colorado Springs, and they have their dream house. It's three stories with a third floor deck. And, it's in a wooded area. And when they were having those terrible forest fires in 2013,
mm-hmm.
I called SOS Radio and I requested, I put in a prayer request for my brother, and I wanted them to play that as many times as they could.
Yep.
The fire stopped 1 mile from their house.
Wow. Incredible. Yeah.
Of course, I was praying for everybody in Colorado Springs, but and that's where Focus on the Family is.
Yeah.
And
I love Focus on the Family. A lot of respect for the Family Research Council that do great work, you know. Oh yeah, yeah.
Do you know this song?
I don't.
10,000 Reasons.
Wow.
And the conclusion.
lovely.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
The other one that I think it puts me in mind of Chris Tomlin's virtuosity. And
that's 10,000 Reasons. I Will Rise. Yeah, I don't think I'd be able to play that on the piano, but...
you know this song.
I've heard this song.
Well, it requires a cello.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, probably. But, you know, there are a lot of... there are a lot of beautiful songs in the contemporary current Christian world mm-hmm. today. And I admit, I wasn't a fan of those songs when it first came mm-hmm. out. Because I was raised on the old hymns.
The same here, like the old Catholic hymns.
Both. Yeah.
Well, no, I know that now, but for me personally, it took time for me to adjust to that.
I can't get through the day without listening to them.
But I know, I realize that now, and I appreciate those songs now, like 10,000 Reasons, Matt Redman, and Brandon Heath, J.J. Heller, and all, name drop it, all the rest of the Christian artists that are out there. But yeah, I just was not a fan of praise music when it first came out. Mm-hmm. It took me time to adjust.
Yeah.
It's not because the music was bad or whatever, because the old hymns talked about the cross a lot.
Right, right.
And Jesus' death, whereas these praise songs are more like praising the Lord. And there's nothing wrong with it.
Exactly.
God is worthy to be praised.
Yeah.
Whatever your religious beliefs are. But,
exactly.
I just had to adjust.
And also,
that's all.
A lot of your background was classical training, as mine was. And when you're used to opera and operatic type themes.
Yeah.
Or the traditional church choir music, it isn't the same. But it is a pop sound that still is meaningful.
Well, I realize that, and it just took time for me to adjust. But I've learned now over the years, I can appreciate praise music, the old hymns, and things like that. Here's a praise tune. I'm not going to tell you the name of it. Listen, now, you may have heard me play it, so let's see if you know this one. Give Me Your Eyes by Brandon Heath.
Yeah, interesting.
Talks about the eyes of God. Because, like, the video has a scene where there's a guy that has a briefcase and suit on. He lost his job, doesn't know how to tell his wife. You know, it's like, see people's pain through the eyes of God is basically
interesting.
What that song's talking about. And that song is just
God's
beautiful
compassion.
Chords.
Yeah, yeah.
I just like those chords.
It is also very similar to the traditional hymn, Open My Eyes So I May See.
Interesting. Yeah, I was just raised on Catholic hymns, to Jesus Christ, our Sovereign King. I don't even that might even be a Protestant one, or hymns about Jesus and the Holy Eucharist, to Mary, or Church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, our Lord, which I love, or Jesus Christ is risen today. That's my favorite hymn,
Oh, mine too.
Yeah, Jesus Christ is risen today. Hallelujah. Christ the Lord is risen today.
I think that's how that goes.
There are two similar ones.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
That is.
You know, even Neil Diamond, I know Neil Diamond is sympathetic to Christianity. I don't know if he's a Christian or not. He may be.
I don't know, he may be. You know, there are a lot of people in Hollywood that are Christians.
He's Judeo-Christian.
That you're Christians, and, you know, they just don't maybe talk about it because of their concerts and acting.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of people that I have seen their testimony on television, like Alice Cooper.
Uh-huh.
You know, he's known for doing all that creepy, creepy dark stuff. But
gimmick.
Saw him. Yeah, it's just an act for him.
Yeah, exactly.
But he was in an interview and he talked about his faith in Jesus Christ. I was really impressed. Alice Cooper.
Wonderful.
He talked about Christ dying on the cross for his sins.
Wonderful.
Another person that gave his testimony was the actor John Ritter, the late John Ritter.
Three's Company. Yeah.
Yeah, he was a Christian too, and he talked about how he asked Jesus Christ to be his Savior.
Wonderful.
When he was younger. Probably before they did Three's Company, because that show was kind of like raunchy for its time.
Yeah, I never liked
it. Just because these actors may do these shows doesn't mean they're not really Christians in real life.
Exactly.
You got to remember that this television is not real, it's just acting.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'll give you a good example. The actor David Carradine that did the Kung Fu TV series.
Oh, vaguely.
In the 70s?
Yeah, I was a kid.
The martial artist, he played Kane. Well, you know, when they shot that series, I looked his bio up. Mm-hmm. When they shot that series, he didn't even know martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
He was a professional dancer, so he was member enough already. And they had a martial arts teacher show him how to memorize certain moves for scenes.
Right.
So, see, my point is television is not real.
Yeah, right? I know that.
These actors do these things, and then they're really Christians in real life. There are a lot of Christians, like, you know, the soap operas. What's her name? Taylor. Oh, I can't think of her name. I think she's on One Life to Live or one of those shows, and she gave her testimony on television, too.
Yeah. Well, anyway, Neil Diamond wrote a wonderful song that I absolutely love. Maybe when I get home, I'll bring it out. It's called Brother Love's Traveling Salvation Show. That is fantastic. You never heard that one?
I don't think I've heard that. I don't think I know that one.
Oh.
You have to have heard it, but you just wouldn't remember.
Oh, it is. It's about, you know, a preacher, and it's very similar to preachers, who basically has 10 revivals and, you know, talks about, you know, your eyes black as coal, and he starts to speak, every air on the place is on him, dun dun, and it has this, you know, and starting, you know, starting slow, then as he starts, you know, preaching, soon the whole valley shakes, love, brother love's traveling salvation show, bring the old ladies, bring the young children, something like this. I haven't heard it in a few years. I just love that song. It's a wonderful song.
And, you know, going back to the idea of Three's Company, that wasn't really so foreign or raunchy to me. Because
I think for its time.
In 1974, out of financial necessity, I accepted the invitation of two young men to share a three-bedroom townhouse with them. And there was absolutely no hanky-panky or anything else like that, except that they liked my cooking. No hanky-panky whatsoever, but I was so reluctant to let my family know that I had male roommates. And my aunt, who visited me, said she wouldn't tell them that I had male roommates because that's the way it was looked at
times.
But there was nothing about it. You know?
Well, it was just considered, I think Three's Company was considered maybe raunchy for its time because it was kind of unheard of in a sense.
Well, yeah, it was.
Men and women living together.
Yeah.
And so they have this man living with these two good-looking women.
But
and
they're
the
just
reason
roommates.
He did it.
They're
yeah, I know.
Just roommates.
But still, just that time, maybe someone's doing some work outside or something. But I mean for that time because, see, the character of Jack Tripper, he wanted to save some money and living expenses, so they came up with that plan that if he lives with these two girls, they have to say he's gay when he really wasn't.
To fool
the landlord.
Yeah.
So
Mr. Roper, yeah.
Yeah, so that was the premise of the show.
And that was a wonderful acting vehicle for the guy who played Mr. Roper.
Yeah.
Well, you know, his name was Norman Fell. He was actually in some detective movies as a young man, Norman Fell. I used to watch him as a little boy when I was growing up. So to see him do this comedic role on Three's Company when he's so known for a tough guy detective, it just took a little adjustment.
Yeah. Well, speaking of Catholic hymns, one of my favorite hymns, which really isn't just Catholic, it's generally Celtic, is Be Thou My Vision. you
never heard that one.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah?
Asaph.
Say it again.
Do you know Be Thou My Vision?
No, don't say it, let me think.
Yes, I've heard that, yes.
I didn't mean to be harsh, it's just I was trying to figure it out in my head. And you would have made me forget, so that's...
And I'm just a flibbertigibbet sometimes.
That's all right. Now I should be able to do it now.
That's a key that I heard in my head.
Yeah, that is, yeah.
And that's, the words to that are something to live by.
Oh, yes.
Just like Philippians 4.
Mm-hmm.
Frequently
yeah, be thou my fount is the name of
yeah,
God.
Yeah.
I frequently do whatsoever things are beautiful,
mm-hmm.
which is an interpretation of Philippians 4.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Whatsoever things are honest and true, lovely,
yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, I was
worthy,
raised on those old
hymns. Concentrate on those things.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I was really raised on the old hymns, and I really appreciate them. They're really wonderful, those old hymns.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, let me do an old hymn, see if you can tell me what the name of it is.
Beautiful.
And how I got acquainted with that song, I went to a Leighton Ford crusade when I was in high school.
Uh-huh.
And he was connected with the evangelist Billy Graham.
And that's John 3:16.
And that was the song that they sang. And I heard that, when I heard the first two verses of that song, it just stuck in my memory. Mm-hmm. And I never forgot it. So that's called From God to Love the World.
Wonderful.
I'll do it again.
Decided on a theme of red, white, and blue, and so I wanted to put together patriotic music. So I was listening to a lot of Sousa marches, and I thought, that's Asaph. He was out there playing that hot trumpet in the Sousa marches all that time. I was marching along with a drum on my leg.
A friend of mine I used to have used to live in Missoula Manor Homes. I was impressed by the Missoula Manor Homes. You mean that assisted living?
It's over on Central. Well, it isn't really. It's independent.
Independent, yeah.
In a senior environment.
I liked it.
People can have caregivers.
Yeah.
But basically, they need to be mobile. And they need to be independently functioning.
Yeah. I liked it. I was really impressed. I would go over to see her, and I was really impressed by the place, you know.
Yeah, I like that song, God Bless America. Mm-hmm. That's a cool song. Do you remember the actor Carol O'Connor on All in the Family?
Oh, yes.
If you remember.
Here they had it went something like this.
He made his reputation
Oh, the one who played Archie Bunker?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And did you know that he went to Carroll College?
No, I did not know that, yeah.
That was his alma mater before he went off to Broadway.
Yeah, well, anyway, that's a short version of the theme. The reason I talked about God Bless America is because on the pilot of that show, they had a scene where he was having an argument with his son-in-law.
Yeah.
And his son-in-law was Polish, and...
Meathead.
And they called him Meathead. Was it before the
Carl
Meathead?
Carl Reiner's son.
Well, they had a scene in there where Archie Bunker didn't think his son-in-law was patriotic, so he starts singing God Bless America while the son-in-law kept arguing with him. He just sit there and just Carol O'Connor kept singing God Bless America, and I found that very amusing.
Mm-hmm.
And then he called him a meathead or something at the end of the song.
Yeah.
You know, I know that show was kind of groundbreaking for its time.
Yeah.
And I know that Norman Lear wasn't trying to promote racism or anything like that. They were just talking about how stupid
exactly
it was.
Reactionary type.
And you know, Archie Bunker just
was
so behind it. And you know, it was all just supreme acting.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, Carol O'Connor was a fine actor.
And
he did some war pictures that I saw way before he ever.
Was fantastic in that.
You know what I really liked her?
Oh, she was really something.
You know, Jean Stapleton, what I really liked about her, did you ever see her portrayal of Mrs. Piggle Wiggle?
Never heard of it.
It's a children's show. She plays this character called Mrs. Piggle Wiggle. And it's just the cutest thing.
Hmm.
And James Whitmore is Mr. Piggle Wiggle in the series. And so this teaches children. It's like kind of like a Mr. Rogers, if I can describe it.
Yeah.
And they had this scene on Mrs. Piggle Wiggle where this little boy didn't know how to tell the truth.
Mm.
So what Mrs. Piggle Wiggle does is she puts a backpack on this kid. And every time he tells a whopper, a rock falls out of the sky, and Mrs. Piggle Wiggle puts it into the bag. So the kid keeps telling these fibs, and so the rocks keep coming, and then it gets heavier and heavier in his backpack. And the kid becomes more uncomfortable because he won't tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
So that was Mrs. Piggle Wiggle's way of getting the boy to tell the truth. And finally, when the bag was too heavy, he started breaking.
Yeah.
And then they had a scene where they had this this certain kind of chocolate cake with tuna fish in it.
Mm-hmm.
And the little boy wanted to say it was the best thing he ever ate, but it wasn't because it had like hot sauce in it. It had chili peppers.
Uh-huh.
They called it chili pepper tuna chocolate cake.
Yeah.
And that was the final straw to teach this boy how to tell the truth. And the only one who really liked the cake was the tree that Mrs. Piggle Wiggle owned.
Huh.
The talking tree that was in her house. So the boy finally confesses and says, "No, I don't like this cake. I didn't fly across the U.S. and my grandfather didn't conquer this and that," and Christopher Lloyd, the actor, played the grandfather.
Mm-hmm.
So they had a great cast. But my point is, Jean Stapleton's character, Mrs. Piggle Wiggle, teaches this boy how to tell the truth, and so then they take the backpack off in the rocks, and he goes back to normal, telling the truth. And it was just such a cool children's
fascinating
show. And I don't think people remember Jane Stapleton as Mrs. Piggle Wiggle, but she was the main character.
Mm.
James Whitmore was Mr. Piggle Wiggle.
And Christopher Lloyd.
Well, he was like a guest on this particular episode of teaching his little boy to tell the truth. And the little boy gets everybody in trouble because he keeps telling these whoppers and stuff until he finally learns how to tell the truth.
Well,
it's just a fun show. If you ever get to watch Mrs. Piggle Wiggle, it's a lot of fun. You can probably see it on the computer. But Jean Stapleton was the
main
character.
Yeah, and Maureen Stapleton was fabulous on Broadway.
Yeah.
And
but,
some films. But what did we hear from Sally Struthers after that?
Oh, she went on to do that fundraising thing for those children that in those impoverished neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And stuff like that. So I really commend her for using her fame and talent to raise money
help
these people in need.
Yeah.
But you know, all of the family had a fantastic cast.
Uh-huh.
And
yeah, they did.
You know, whatever you thought of that character of Archie Bunker, that show was amusing because it always showed how stupid this character was when everybody else knew that racism was wrong. But Archie was...
Yeah, but his wasn't just racism. It was general... general antagonism.
He just didn't like anything or anybody.
Yeah, yeah.
And the character of Lionel, it was funny because when Lionel Jefferson would go visit the Bunker house, how you doing there, Mr. Bunker? You know, he would talk like that. Yeah. I want to be an engineer, you know?
Yeah.
Just to feed into his ego.
Yeah.
And then when Archie would lead a room, they would just laugh at him.
Yeah.
But,
one television program that I thought was extremely unfunny, I don't know if you'll ever like it, I did not, Happy Days.
Oh, I did not care for Happy Days.
I did not at all. I
now, this is no offense to Henry Winkler.
Yeah.
And Ron
but
Howard.
But Ronnie Howard was good.
No, I'm going to tell you why I didn't care for that show. It had nothing to do with their acting.
Yeah.
It had nothing to do with Fonzie. I'm an African-American person. And
yes.
In that time zone, the relationship between the black and white people as far as that culture.
Yeah.
It wasn't there. And I know that the character of Fonzie wasn't racist, but when I look at Happy Days, that's what I see. I see that time period. It's just like if you were Jewish.
Exactly.
And you watched Hogan's Heroes with Bob Crane. That just wouldn't sit well if you were Jewish.
I just didn't
you know, Hogan's Heroes didn't promote the Nazis and stuff. That's the way I saw Happy Days. And so
I just didn't like Fonzie's character. I thought he was arrogant. I thought, this is just, I can't relate to it. And his friends, I thought, were jerks. And it's like, this isn't funny. I just didn't think, hey, sit on it. I thought he was just an arrogant.
One thing I did like about the character of Fonzie. He always protected his friends.
That was a good thing, yes.
And he could just whoop anybody.
That was good.
Yeah, he would always come across like he was a this hardcore was going to let his friends get in trouble, but he never let his friends get in trouble.
Yeah, yeah.
And there was no one that could defeat Fonzie, one. And I appreciated that about that character.
That was good. That was
good. He always protected his friends.
Yeah.
And they had this, there was one episode they had, well, two episodes that caught my attention on Happy Days.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about that for a moment. They had this episode where they were talking about prejudice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Fonzie was against racism and against prejudice. You know?
Yes.
And so they had this thing where there was an African-American drummer in the band at Arnold's restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were going to have this party. But the parents of Ralph Malph and everybody else didn't want those characters to go because of this African-American drummer.
Yeah.
And Fonzie thought because he was so cool, he could persuade these people to come to that party anyway, even though the parents said no.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody shows up at this party, and so Fonzie was ticked off, and he was going to go and get in the face of that whole neighborhood for not going to this party because of this African-American drummer. And Mr. Cunningham had to teach Fonzie that there's one thing that's more stronger than being cool, and that's prejudice.
Yeah.
That was a lesson Fonzie had to learn. No matter how cool he is, racism is still racism.
Yeah.
And that's something Fonzie himself had to deal with.
Yeah, interesting.
Now, that episode caught my attention.
Yeah, that would be almost a good episode. I'd almost like
it. It did.
Yeah, that was very good.
And
I just didn't like the...
another episode where Fonzie had to learn about forgiveness.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
Because... you know when I told you he can whoop anybody?
Uh-huh.
Well, they had this episode where there was... and Tom Hanks was the star of this one. A very young Tom Hanks. Tom Hanks got picked on a lot as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
The character in Happy Days.
Yeah.
So what he does is he takes martial arts as a kid and he grows up and then he goes back to that neighborhood where Fonzie was to get even with Fonzie.
Mm-hmm.
And so they had a scene where Tom Hanks does this martial arts move on Fonzie and he... punches him and Fonzie goes backwards through the window of Arnold's and stuff. And so Tom Hanks' character thinks, okay, I'm feeling good. I defeated Fonzie, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fonzie comes out of the front of the restaurant like he always did because, you know, there's an old saying that you can punch me once, you get the first punch, and after that, you're dog meat.
Yep.
And Fonzie was going to go after this guy.
Oh,
he was going to destroy this guy, even though he was a martial arts expert.
Mm-hmm.
And Fonzie decides to forgive him instead of hitting him.
Good, that's a good
and
one.
And that taught that martial arts expert, Tom Hanks' character, it's not about martial arts to get even with somebody.
That's right, that is right, you know.
So Fonzie decided, because Fonzie could have destroyed him, even though... the martial arts guy got the first punch.
And it was maturity on the part of Fonzie to recognize that he perhaps had come across incorrectly with the Tom Hanks character. caused him to seek revenge.
Yeah, because see, Fonzie, was, when he walked in there, you know, Fonzie had that look like, okay, I'm going to kill you. Now he had the first hit. And right when he had that look, you know, that menacing look like he's going to hit someone, he decides to forgive the guy.
That's good.
So they went on to become friends. Now, those were two episodes that were an exception, but...
Yeah, the exception to the robot.
Because of the topic. But normally, as far as when you watch Happy Days...
Yeah.
Or like American Graffiti, the movie...
Yeah, I never cared for American Graffiti either.
That was tough for me to watch as an African-American. Just like if you were Jewish, like I mentioned, watching Hogan's Heroes... Okay, thank you. I'm watching at time. So, but that's funny that you mentioned Happy Days. I mean, Happy Days was a fine show. It was popular.
Oh yeah,
I'm not telling people don't watch Happy Days.
Exactly. If you like
Happy
Days,
I'm just saying that me, Happy Days, that was not for me. Laverne and Shirley, that was not for
me. Oh no, no, not Laverne and Shirley.
All those shows.
Or Cheers or Friends. Cheers.
Yeah, see, those shows were not for me. But, you know, if you want to watch those shows,
exactly,
fine. Because Ted Danson, all those people are fine actors. And I like him on CSI. He's pretty smooth on Ted Danson's character.
But the thing is...
At CSI.
They just become so mundane and almost meaningless that you're going, who wants to watch mindless entertainment?
Exactly.
And why not watch something that... learn something from, or that has a high cultural or spiritual content, you know, like the History Channel.
Yeah, the History Channel is good,
Or Antiques Roadshow.
Uh-huh.
Well, see, the thing about these sitcoms, they always make the fathers out to be like the doofus.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That's
not
right.
not like Ward Cleaver. You ever watch Leave It to Beaver? Really?
Oh,
watch that?
Never have.
You've never watched that?
Well,
yeah,
you aren't in our time zone.
The father, Ward Cleaver, was just such a strong family man.
Mm-hmm.
And,
well,
and
just like...
They don't have that on sitcoms anymore with the fathers.
I might have years ago as a kid. I can't remember. Yeah,
yeah,
I might have.
Little Beaver and Wally and, you know, I mean, that's the way
father knows
is.
Best.
Oh, yeah, father
all
knows
those
best.
Shows,
that was good.
The Donna Reed show, all those shows, especially Ward Cleaver, they were, like, strong...
Yeah,
father image, or like the Rifleman, Chuck Connors.
Oh, yeah,
that's what a father should be.
Exactly.
And it's almost Father's Day anyway, so we might as well talk about fathers for a little bit. But now they've got like these fathers that are just so wimpy. Like their kids tell the fathers what to do. They don't discipline their kids and stuff like that. It's just
echoing the moral decay in our population.
It is. Yeah, it is.
And I'm not gonna pick on John Ritter. He was one of those weak dads.
Parents should work
on that.
Together instead of opposing each other or taking the other person down and belittling the other person's meaning and effectiveness. They should work together. You know, my parents did.
Uh-huh.
And so, yes, you're right. We've had an overdo it.
Yeah.
You know, I don't believe in head of household.
Exactly.
Authority or anything.
No.
Well, you know, let's talk about that for a second, because you know, there's a Bible verse about. Well, there's a Bible verse about women submitting to their husbands, and I think, well, first of all, women frown on that and they fear that because men abuse that.
Yes.
That is right.
Now, when they were talking about submissive, here's a great illustration. Let's take the military.
Mm-hmm.
You have a chain of command, right? You have like sergeants and admirals and generals and, you know, all that. And when they're talking about submitting, they're talking about in function. The military could not function without the role of the chain of command.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that one soldier is better than another. The higher ranking one is what makes that organization work.
Yeah.
And they, you know, you apply that to the family. It's not a dictatorial where the guy says, you know, wipe my shoes and have dinner wait for me when I walk right in the door.
Yeah,
it's a
yeah.
two-way thing because the New Testament also says the husband is to submit to the wife, meaning, like, let's say there's a major decision.
Yeah.
The wife might come up with an idea that the husband didn't think of, and that husband should think about that
exactly.
and take that wife's advice.
Exactly.
It's not this Fred Flintstone,
yeah,
I rule the castle thing, and
yeah,
a lot of men abuse that, and that's why women resist that. But that's not what the old, I mean, excuse me, the New Testament is talking about when it says submitting. They're talking about in the functional
cooperate
home.
With.
Yeah.
The man is to when he's the head, it means that, for example, it could be in a decision. Again, the man might make that final decision, but what they don't tell you is that man is going to be accountable to the Lord for how he runs that family and the decision he makes on behalf of his family and stuff like that. But see, our culture doesn't tell you that part of it. They just harp on the man is the boss.
Yes.
Get my cigar.
Yeah.
Shame. No, that's it.
Exactly.
I'd tell him where to. If I was a girl, a husband said that, I'd tell him where to go. Tell where he can stick that.
However,
all right, this is a family show. I won't go no further than
right.
Despite our modern television shows, despite the reaction to male domination, it's worse in Islamism than it is in Judeo-Christianism. But there are many people who do not realize that the original inhabitants of the British Isles were female, were matriarchal. Their families were were headed by women, and the person who was the supreme commander of Britain when the Romans first encountered and conquered it was a queen. And believe it or not, she was an extremely huge redhead.
That a hint because you're red?
No. The native people who really were called the Quimri valued red hair in either man or woman. And a lot of them were redheaded. Of course, them even more became redheaded when they intermarried with the Vikings.
Well, you know, it's almost time for us to conclude, but...
All right. Father's Day is coming up, so get your Father's Day gifts.
And if you're fortunate enough to be a father, take care of your family.
Yes.
You know, don't treat your wife like Fred Flintstone.
Yeah.
You know, she's your companion, not your slave, you know?
Yeah.
And on that note, let me make some final acknowledgments. And I'm not picking on Fred Flintstone, because I like the Flintstones myself. Yeah. In fact, I went to the Hanna-Barbera studio years ago, and they gave me a tour how they made the Flintstones and the Jetsons and Adamant and all the other characters. And at that time, they didn't have the computers, so they took me down this corridor where there were professional portraits drawn of Fred Flintstone and Wilma and Barney and Betty and all the rest of those characters from the Hanna-Barbera. So, you know, I'm not here to pick on Fred Flintstone, but no, don't treat your wife like Fred does. And on that note, let's make some final acknowledgments. Emmett, thanks for being part of our show.
Certainly.
You can be part of the second show you'll like, because time goes by when we do these shows. And our guest, Linda Brooks Curtis. And we're going to be doing show number 2 here in a little bit. We'll have Patty Reed, our hostess and our mascot. So I hope you guys enjoyed the food.
Yes, thank you so much.
And leave the microphones on. I'll shut everything off there when I slip out.
Happy trails to you.
That's a good way to do that. We'll end the show with happy trails. Yeah. And until our next show, ladies and gentlemen, I am Asaph Adonai, Maranatha.
Maybe if I'm ever on again, I can discuss more about easy listening, including like contemporary instrumental, or like I love William Ackerman and George Winston, and you know, that's beautiful, but that will be for another show, if, you know, whatever, you know.
You better be.
Yep, I will be. God bless you all.
Thank you. Happy trails, and we'll end this show with that.
All right.